Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another webinar from the Philips Lighting Academy. Today's webinar is titled Digitized Illumination, and it is presented by Bob Karlicek from the Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute.
Thank you very much, everyone. I'd like to thank Philips for giving me this opportunity to talk about some of the work that we're doing here at Rensselaer on advanced lighting systems. This work is sponsored by the National Science Foundation here, and it's dedicated to the development of new digitized systems that allow us to bring new applications to illumination. And here at the center, I have the privilege of working with a lot of talented faculty, graduate and undergraduate students, and mostly what I'll be doing today is talking about some of their exciting work in driving digitized illumination to provide new advanced applications and services. I think everyone knows by now that lighting is becoming driven by solid-state lighting, and LEDs are really taking over. In this country, in the Super Bowl earlier this year, it was the first time that a major sports event was 100% lit by light-emitting diodes. I like to use this slide because, first of all, my team won this particular event. But more importantly than that, it highlights just how far solid-state lighting has come since the first white light-emitting diode systems were advertised in the mid-1990s. And what we can advertise from this particular event was that the lighting quality was extremely good, a lot less energy was used than previously used by incumbent lighting systems, and the providers of the lighting system advertised a 20-year lifetime for this particular environment. Now, whether or not these LEDs will last a full 20 years remains to be seen, but the reality of the situation is the lifetime and the energy of the efficiency of light-emitting diodes are really redefining the lighting market. And these things are really driving major changes in how lighting industries are approaching illumination. And I beg the question, will simply providing illumination be enough for future lighting companies to survive? And I think that's the question that's driving a lot of change in the illumination industry today. So the impacts of LEDification, which is actually a word that's been coined by Philips, really drives a number of interesting things. First of all, I think everyone would agree that due to reliability and due to new form functions, we're going to see the gradual death of the bulb socket model. It's going to take a long time to go away, but I believe it's ultimately going to disappear. I think also that we're going to find that control systems, which were previously used to save energy, are no longer cost-effective for lighting energy savings. And the payback period, if the control systems are going to be paid for by electrical energy savings themselves, will not be able to have a reasonable return on investment period. And finally, we really believe that brand new applications, uniquely enabled by digitized illumination, will drive future lighting businesses in some of the areas you see down below, like visible light communications, human-centric lighting, or enhanced human performance, novel building management systems where lighting becomes not only the illumination, but the eyes of the building control systems, and even new and exciting areas of LED applications in plant growth and novel horticultural applications. So these are going to be some of the future things that are going to drive the lighting businesses going forward. And you see some of this now in work being done by lighting companies all over the world. Tunable lighting in education with outcomes on student performance. Tunable light in the workplace where you can have highly specialized, personalized lighting for individuals in the work environment. Visible light communications is starting to become popular with new entrants, not so much in visible light communication, but digitized illumination for shopping applications, indoor GPS. And finally, tunable lighting in healthcare where people are beginning to explore just how far we can take lighting in terms of improving health and recovery of people in the healthcare system. But it begs the question that with all these new features and services, how will people actually control complex lighting services where color tuning, health, digital information, and other outcomes are going to require interacting with the lighting system? It's going to be a lot more complicated than simply having an on-off switch in a dimmer. And it begs the question of just how smart do these systems need to become? So here at the Engineering Research Center at RPI, where we deal with advanced lighting-enabled systems, we like to talk about interactive illumination systems that are an interplay of digitized tunable lighting, very advanced light sensors, and then interactive controls and communications. These systems are going to drive lighting control systems that have high bandwidth with no observable latency. Of course, wireless communications will be augmented by light in addition to conventional radio frequency communication systems. But in addition to that, we'll have high-quality, human-centric, adaptive, responsive lighting. And most importantly, lighting systems will be able to sense the lighting environment and preserve privacy of the individuals being illuminated while doing it. And these systems will all work together to be able to drive radically new kinds of applications of lighting systems in the future. Now, I frequently like to use, and some of you who have heard me speak before may have seen, this analogy between autonomous control systems and complex systems. And, of course, on the top left-hand side, you see the Google Autonomous Car Program. You all know that many automobile companies today are developing actively robotically controlled car systems that can drive without human intervention. It features a lot of applications where the car can now do things better than people, and what the car essentially has is an embedded expert driver. Well, I'd like to make the argument in this analogy that autonomous lighting systems will be required to fully deliver the benefits of color-tunable responsive lighting. It's going to be too complex for people to control easily. And you're going to be able to derive these advantages when the intelligence is embedded in the system. Now, no analogies are perfect. And in this particular case, the self-driving car can sense its environment and it can steer and redirect itself to protect its occupants. Lighting systems are going to have to evolve to be able to control the light, where it goes, what's being illuminated to maximize the human performance and adequacy or quality of the lighting environment. And that's going to drive some interesting changes in not only the lighting system design, but also in the sensor systems that are going to be able to enable fully autonomous lighting control systems, where now you're going to have an embedded lighting expert. So the controls are removed from burdening the individual occupants of a space. Now, the bigger problem that we see here at the Engineering Research Center is really that lighting systems are essentially blind. And a fundamental premise of any engineered system is that systems that cannot see what they're doing or cannot measure what they're supposed to control can, in fact, not really enable control. And the sensors that we have today available for lighting systems are not really adequate to the task. We have occupancy sensors and thermal array imagers, ultrasonic sensors, and yes, even ambient light sensors that do sense light, but not really adequately to be able to properly measure illumination profiles, localize people and things in their environment, preserve privacy, and ultimately be very low cost. And these are really some of the things that I think we really need to be able to drive in terms of a sensing system that is enabling light to become fully digitized and interact with people in the environment. So I'd like to start with this picture that advertises something that we call the planoptic light field function. In this planoptic light field function, we have a rendering of an environment that can be calculated by assuming where the light sources are, the spectral output of the light sources, the reflectivities of everything in the environment, and how the photons move throughout that space. Now, if we could just come up with a way to adequately measure the planoptic light field of illuminated space, we would find that the photons in that space contain a tremendous amount of information on the color of objects, timing, of course, because we can modulate the light-emitting diodes, but a lot of the properties that lighting systems need to be able to know about to autonomously control the lighting for the benefit of their occupants. That information is contained in the planoptic light field function. And I think that the major point I want to make with this particular slide is that if you can simply sample the photons in a space and know, first of all, where they were created, secondly, where they had been, and third, how long it took to get to the sensor, then you could determine a lot of the properties of the illuminated space that would enable autonomous lighting control systems. And perhaps more importantly than that, you can do this with a camera, but you won't have the overhead processing information of a camera, which provides too much information. And perhaps most importantly, you can do this without invading people's privacy. And so I want to show you some of the work that we're doing in the Engineering Research Center, but it starts with the fact that we realized a long time ago that wireless communications can be done by light. We all know about optical fibers and free space optical communications, and in fact, Li-Fi or communications, wireless communications with light is becoming popular. But a lot of people know that there is a large and rapidly growing need for bandwidth. And this bandwidth can be met by actually digitizing the light to transmit information that can be used for wireless communications. And this growth of very rapid demand for wireless information is going to put some tremendous strains on the radio frequency systems that are available today. I frequently ask people in talks whether or not they're happy with their download speeds today, and I usually don't find that anyone is. So lighting can provide an enhancement with this bandwidth, and that in part will drive the digitization of illumination. But there's another factor that I'd like to highlight here, and very recently in the IEEE spectrum, some RF noise experts pointed out that the Internet of Things, which is going to be rapidly increasing the amount of RF spectrum used for communications, is also going to slow down bandwidth speeds because of the noise involved in all of these RF devices communicating with each other. Now, I'm not arguing that radio frequency systems will not be able to do the job. They're going to be an important part of wireless communications. I'm simply saying that lighting can dramatically augment the ability of lighting systems and communication systems to share data wirelessly, particularly in high-density environments. And it's this combination of visible light communications and illumination that really led the professors and the students of the Smart Lighting Engineering Research Center here at Rensselaer to start taking a look at, well, if lighting is going to be digitized and modulated, what else can we draw from the lighting system besides wireless data that might help us do a better job of determining how the lighting system is supposed to be sensed and controlled? And so we have this joint dual-use paradigm of visible light communications and light sensing that both required modulated lighting. And really, they're birds of a feather. Invisible light communications sensors in smart devices, not necessarily PDAs like this old particular image shows, are going to be able to detect both radio frequency and visible light communications. If you take variations of those sensors and put them in the ceiling, then you can start to measure the properties of the photons that I talked about before, where they were created, what they've been reflected off of, and how long it took for them to be absorbed by a sensor. And so the center here has been exploring the possibility of this dual-use paradigm by digitizing the light, and we combined two basic technologies to figure out how to sense light to be able to better control it, one of which is time-of-flight sensing, where we use the modulation of light to be able to measure distances between the light source, the sensor, and things that are being illuminated, and what we call light transport analysis. And I want to really be able to show you how those systems work as we take a look at some of the opportunities or some of the research that we're doing here at the center. So what the center has done is built what we call a smart conference room. There are color tunable lights that are in this room. You can see them shown in the bottom image. These lights are five color systems so that we can control the color very accurately. And if you look carefully at the top image, you can see a series of spots in the ceiling that are these sensors that allow us to measure light transport, intensity, color, and timing of light that's transiting throughout the room. We can also measure the daylight coming in from the windows and some other things I'll show you momentarily. So we have the color tunable lighting so that we can explore human-centric lighting, do reflectivity mapping, and even metameric matching that can tend to impact how people perform in their jobs. We do the time-of-flight sensing, and we do this other application that we like to call light transport mapping, where we complement time-of-flight methods to be able to take a look at how to build a human system interface based on where photons came from, what they've hit in the room, and how long it took for them to make that round trip. So we use this digitized light to compute things using this top-down cartoon of the smart conference room to determine how many occupants there are in a space, where they are. We try to estimate what they're doing, and then using this information, try to determine with other information about the building and other information that we know about the people, what is the right light for the application that they're trying to develop. This information can be fed to lighting control systems, of course, but it can also enable new kinds of building services, more efficient energy use in buildings by better control of HVAC systems, data services, security, and even in some applications, healthcare services. So these are some of the things that we envision being able to do with digitized illumination. So I have a couple of videos that I'd like to kind of run through now to show how these systems work. And this advertises time-of-flight 3D mapping and tracking of individuals in the space. This is the smart conference room with some of our students walking in to sit down to, per se, begin a meeting. And you can see in the top left panels, there's a top-down view of what the cameras actually see in measuring time of flight. Now, these are not infrared images, but these are distance images that show the location and estimate the pose of individuals in the room. The bottom panel in that left-hand side is just the same people with the table mathematically removed from the image. But you'll note that we can see if people are standing or sitting and figure out where they are localized in this space. And that's kind of shown in the bottom panel where we measure the distance or the height of the objects and the people in the space. And we can figure out if they're standing or sitting. And you can see that this video is looping around. Now, right now, we're using infrared time-of-flight cameras. But we're also doing experiments on moving to single-pixel time-of-flight systems that will allow us to significantly reduce the cost and improve the performance of these kinds of systems. And some of that is shown in this conference room here, which is a little bit different than our smart conference room. This is an experimental test bed where we have installed in the ceiling, along with a couple of our graduate students, single-pixel time-of-flight sensors that can localize individuals and estimate where they are in the space. And so you can see with a fairly sparse arrangement of time-of-flight sensors, you can localize individuals and you can process that information relatively quickly. So we're making progress now on going from time-of-flight cameras, which are commercially available and have been for some time, to very low-cost, single-pixel time-of-flight sensors that allow us to figure out where people are and estimate whether they're standing or sitting and try to estimate the tasks that may require a particular kind of illumination. We like to do simulations of this space to try to figure out exactly what the single pixel spacing needs to be, what our sensor density needs to be. And so we do a lot of modeling to be able to take a look at where people are and how they're moving around. And we can estimate through this simulation what the accuracy of the occupancy count would be, and also what the accuracy of the pose estimation is, whether people are standing or sitting or lying down. And we do this simulation to optimize the distribution of the time-of-flight sensors in the space. And so with this information, we can begin to compute what kind of illumination is required for the space. But in addition to that, we can also begin to provide data about how the space is being utilized to be able to create other smart applications for building services, healthcare, and so on, as I discussed previously. So here's a simple application, and one of our professors, who's actually one of the leaders of this particular testbed application, feigns a fall. The lighting system can detect it, as you can see. This may not necessarily be the preferred alerting method, but the light changes color to indicate that in this location, someone has fallen. When motion is detected, the lighting system returns to normal. And this is a very, very simple application of how the lighting system is aware of what's going on in the space. You can see that this could be useful for elder care facilities. It could be useful for a wide variety of applications where safety is important. But most importantly, you can see that we're doing this without the use of a camera. And we can figure out things like whether or not people are safe. Even in some cases, we can figure out, you know, how frequently people move, whether or not they're not moving often enough, whether or not they're going someplace and then seem to forget where they're going. The lighting system can do these kinds of tasks and alert people that there are issues again, without using cameras, so that there's no limitation on where these kinds of systems can be placed from a privacy point of view. Now, I want to switch gears a little bit and talk about another application of digitized light, which is light transport. And this gets back to the comment that I made earlier, where if we could simply know the origin of photons, what light fixture made them, where they'd been, and what systems in the room they actually bounced off of, the spectral reflectance, and how long it took for them to make the trip, which was the part I previously talked about with time-of-flight sensing, the light transport basics can also be used to figure out where people and things were, and in some sense can be used to fill in the blanks between simple time-of-flight sensors. And we do this light transport analysis by superimposing a very small high-speed perturbation on the light signal. This can be, in fact, a visible light communication signal, which is transmitting data on one hand to an occupant in the room, but on the other hand is bouncing off the walls and the tables and going back to the lighting system to figure out where the light had been. When we take a look at these digitized signals bouncing around the room, we can calculate differences in the space's digital signature and figure out through light transport kind of what's been going on in that space. And so this is envisioned in this cartoon over here, where I can use these kinds of technologies to be able to localize with a high degree of probability that there are three individuals standing in the space around this table in the smart conference room, and I can track their motion because I'm using a very simple sensor to be able to detect these digital signatures. And the data processing overhead is really quite light. And so here's a video that shows us an application. We have one of our graduate students walking through the conference room. You can see in the bottom tile that we can localize this individual as they move from section to section. This is done by taking a look at how the digitized light is flowing throughout the space. And we're essentially looking at the digital signature of the space by looking at the digitized illumination patterns. I like to drive this analogy where it's kind of like water flowing in a stream. If you throw a rock into the stream, you change the flow of water. Similarly, in a space, using this approach, if you change the position of anyone or anything, you change the flow of light. And if we can detect these changes in the flow of light, we can infer things about this space that allow us to do a better job of controlling services that are provided to the individual in the space, lighting, heating, cooling, other services that may be necessary to meet the needs of the individual occupants of the space. Now, we're taking this smart conference room right now, and we're taking a look at being able to apply it in some other areas that I think are going to be really very important. I should mention here that the Engineering Research Center here at Rensselaer is supported by other schools. The National Science Foundation requires us to be multi-institutional, and we have three other partner schools with professors and students that support this research on advanced lighting systems, one of which is the University of New Mexico. Boston University is the second, and the third is Thomas Jefferson University in Philadelphia. At the School of Medicine at the University of New Mexico, they have a hospital room which is now being converted to a sensorized smart illumination space, which is going to be used to explore applications of digitized lighting in an hospital environment. Of course, we'll be doing some work on the color of light and the well-being of patients in the space. But we're also going to be doing work on sleep disorders, which is a key research area of the center. We'll be capable of doing patient tracking in this room. And perhaps with this kind of a lighting system, we can not only sense the environment of the lighting in motion, but we can even tie this kind of light dose information and patient motion to electronic medical records, which could be an important part of the overall therapy program for individual patients in the space. As I said, this particular export of our smart conference room technology to this hospital room is underway right now and should be operational in the next couple of months. And we're eager to look at this kind of application of digitized illumination and sensing in healthcare applications. And we view this as a tool that will allow us to accelerate the research that's being done on lighting, spectral control, and healthcare. it's a very popular research area all across the world, and these tools hopefully will accelerate progress in this space. We have some other applications that we're really very interested in. These forward-looking applications, one of which involves what I like to call the fusion of illumination and video information, involved the work at our center in putting together virtual hospital windows for hospital rooms where there were no windows. And what we found was that it significantly improved the outcomes and the mood of people in these rooms. In this particular virtual hospital window shown on this slide, we have a high-resolution LCD TV tied to a camera on the roof of the hospital room with light panels on either side of the TV. These light panels adjust their color and intensity depending upon the image in the screen so that you can really mirror the image. In fact, people walking into these rooms first go over to the window and try to raise the blinds. What we found was that people really rated the virtual window equal to a normal window, and about 20%, almost 1 in 5, or about 1 in 5, liked the virtual window better than the normal window because they could see what was going on. Now, this seems like a very simple application. You could argue that televisions aren't very energy efficient. It would be much better to just install a regular window, and this is true. But with new technologies in micropixelated displays and much more energy efficient display technology that is being developed today by companies like Apple and others throughout the world, we hope that this might become an energy efficient way to be able to create images that simulate daylighting in certain kinds of applications. Beyond that, as people start taking a look at more advanced lighting systems that perhaps use lasers, we see the development of lighting systems that are going to fuse illumination and projection applications to create virtual immersive environments that will be able to not only deliver light and measure the location of applicants, but also deliver graphic information or graphics and digital information on walls and surfaces. And I think lighting companies, as they take a look at how to develop sustainable business models, will be looking at these kinds of applications. And then down at the bottom, a new area that we started to take a look at is how we can use digitized lighting to optimize plant growth. And we like to look at digitized lighting because we can actually use digitized lighting to generate the chlorophyll A fluorescence in plants. And we can track plant stress by monitoring the plants in real time using the characteristics of the fluorescence. Now, this fluorescence is very well known, but using advanced sensor systems to be able to drive this kind of behavior allows us to do some interesting things with plants. And some of these things are known already, but we want to control it in more detail by using digitized light. Shown on the right-hand side are a number of different heads of lettuce, but we found that by carefully controlling the spectrum, you can convert the red lettuce from being mostly green to mostly red in as little as 24 hours through careful spectral control. So the advanced luminaire and sensor technologies that we're talking about are going to require some breakthroughs in lighting, and they're going to require some breakthroughs in sensing. And the center is also working in each of these fields to take a look at some of the things that need to be done to make this vision of autonomous digitized lighting systems a reality. And so one of the things that's going to be completely required of future lighting systems is going to be able to shape or steer the light just like you steer self-driving cars. And I'm sorry here, let me just go back a second and restart this movie. And in this particular view graph, what we've developed at Boston University with Professor Bishop and his graduate student, Jessica Morrison, is a MEMS-based, it's a unique MEMS-based system that can steer light around a space so that we can control the distribution of photons in the space. These systems can be used with LEDs or lasers to be able to do optical beam steering. We have a number of other programs at the ERC that are not MEMS-based that we're exploring to be able to do digitized control of the illumination patterns that get generated. So like the self-driving car, which can steer its course, the lighting system can steer its photons to where they're needed to be able to create a given kind of lighting environment. And so light shaping technology is going to become critical for future lighting systems because they need to be responsive to the individuals in the environment or changes in how the environment are actually used. New kind of sensors are also going to be required. And so in work that's a collaboration of researchers at the University of New Mexico and at Rensselaer, we're looking at new kind of light sensors that can simultaneously resolve color and direction. And in this kind of an application, resolving color and direction, we use a CMOS, meaning low cost, compatible avalanche photodiode array, so we get very good responsivity. And we, by interrogating this array, can discern what color the light is, what its intensity is, and where it came from. And so we hope to develop these kinds of what we call planoptic light field sensors to replace some of the simple light sensors that we're using now, to be able to measure the characteristics of light, where they came from, how long they took to get to where they were going, and the information that they gathered along the way, so that we can do a better job of really designing autonomous digitized lighting systems that deliver all the capabilities of color tunable digitized illumination to people without burdening them with the need to figure out how to control it. So at this point, I think I've gone through just about all of my material. I'd like to simply state that it's the view of the center that the future of lighting is going to be in value-added systems that really enable other smart systems. It's not so much smart lighting as much as it is lighting that enables other smart applications in healthcare, in virtual reality applications, in cognitive immersive environments, in building management systems, in horticulture, and indeed visible light communications. We believe that digitized illumination with the proper sensors and in the right distribution will use this digitized light field to generate the data required for these new applications. And this data will be relatively unique compared to the kinds of data that these systems get today from other less adequate sensors. And then finally, the lighting industry, as we know it today, and I think that most people that I've talked to in the lighting industry would agree with this, is in the process of being completely transformed, integrated with new information technology-driven markets, and the illumination is going to be different. High-quality, color-tunable illumination will become a commodity. More importantly, we're going to be able to sense and do new and different things with digitized illumination than we've ever been able to do before. And the research at the center is really looking to drive a lot of that kind of advanced development work. So with that, I'd like to acknowledge our funding organizations, the National Science Foundation in particular, that funds these engineering research centers to be able to take advanced technology from the university to the marketplace. I'd also like to acknowledge funding from New York State and our approximately 25 engineering research industry members who are very interested in seeing what we are working on and also very interested in hiring our graduate students. Since the Smart Lighting Engineering Research Center was founded in 2008, we've graduated 31 PhD students between the four academic institutions with advanced knowledge in advanced lighting systems. I'd like to thank, of course, our Smart Lighting ERC faculty and students, and remind everybody that we're really trying to develop lighting systems that think about how to illuminate a space and provide advanced services for other people, for other services, for other applications, so that lighting systems will be able to do much more than simply illuminate. And with that, I'd like to thank you all and take some time on...